Chupa, as you see on your screen, is our reigning Toronto Regional Champion, but in the last year, made it to the finals of San Diego Regionals, the very first Scarlet and Violet Regional Championship.
Using Dondozo?
Yes, using Dondozo. That was last January, too, so that's his second, at least top four finish at a regional in January with Dondozo, but also making top eight at OCIC and NAIC last year. So very impressive resume just in the past year. Of course, many Top Cuts regionals even before that. Running these team that we have seen of Ogerpon Teal Mask, the pure grass type, Dragonite, Dondozo, Qianpao, Glamora, and the Tatsugiri Curly form, which when paired with Dondozo's Order Up will boost its attack.
Yeah, this is an extremely interesting look at the Dondozo teams, making some slight adjustments for the Regulation F metagame. Like he mentioned, this Glamora with Meteor Beam and Power Herb, you know, there are so many things that that Glamora is able to just pick up one-hit KOs on because of the sheer power of both the Glamora and that attack. And if it doesn't pick up a KO, it's at least chunking it down, and sometimes that's all Dondozo needs. But Dondozo has to get through Colin Heyer, who, like you mentioned, is actually the third place in the 2014 World Championships, but is a multiple regional champion and regional finalist, and of course, also made it to the top eight of the Oceania International Championships last year.
Yeah, one of at least, I think, four Americans that made top eight at that OCIC alongside Chupa. But we are going to see Colin running a team of Fluttermane, Ogerpon Wellspring Mask, Dragonite, Entei, Raging Bolt, and Qianpao. And I think this is at least the third unique Raging Bolt item we've seen on stream so far this weekend.
That's true. This is the Life Orb variant of Raging Bolt. So trying to opt for extreme damage over survivability and anti-Amoongus technology that we've seen with the safety goggles and we've seen with Leftovers and Calm Mind in the past.
I think it's really cool too. The Dondozo is very vulnerable to special attacks. It does not have the greatest special defense, even when it's boosted by that commander ability from Tatsugiri. So if the Raging Bolt is on the field and Dondozo has been boosted, Thunderclap and Thunderbolt are both really big damage threats. You can even start going for some Draco Meteors. A Life Orb Draco Meteor will hit very hard regardless of whether Dondozo terrestrializes or not. Because it is unaware, if you are at minus two special attack with Draco Meteor, you can hit for the same exact power because those stat drops will be ignored. So I think Raging Bolt, a big damage threat into the Dondozo, but we're not going to see it just yet.
Yeah, no Dondozo just yet. It's going to be the Glamora and Ogerpon lead from Chupa. We saw this pretty regularly coming out from Carson Confer earlier in the tournament, who was running the same team. This Glamora and Ogerpon lead is extremely strong at picking off an individual Pokemon. But Fluttermane and Ogerpon for Colin are both potentially going to be difficult to get off the field. Both of them would be really high priority targets to make way for the Dondozo in the back, if it's in the back.
Glamora, actually one of the few Pokemon that stands up to Fluttermane pretty well as well. It is able to resist those Moonblasts and Dazzling Gleams thanks to the Poison typing. And we did see that it is the special attack boosting Fluttermane with the Booster Energy Protosynthesis combo for Colin. So it's not the speed boosting set that we've seen some players run this weekend. We're going back to the full power Booster Energy, kind of one step below those choice specs, but gives you the added flexibility.
Well, this added flexibility includes being able to protect. Colin just going for a double protect here on both the Fluttermane and the Ogerpon, trying to figure out what Chupa wants to do in this matchup. The Ivy Cudgel will be targeting the Fluttermane into the protect. Glamora's also going for the Meteor Beam, of course, will not be able to get any damage off because of the protects, but using that power up does get the special attack boost. So even though no damage, plus one on Glamora is really scary.
Yeah, that's a kind of a trade-off there for Chupa. You get no damage off with Meteor Beam, which means that option is kind of no longer available to you, but you do still get that special attack boost. So if you want to go for Meteor Beam, that Power Herb was already used up. You have to take the full two turns, but you do get the advantage of the plus one special attack Sludge Bombs, which into this Ogerpon could be a very big threat because it is weak to that poison type move. Fluttermane now kind of in the same spot. Like the Ogerpon on Chupa's side is not that Hearthflame form. It does not resist any kind of fairy type attacks. So any kind of Moonblast or Dazzling Gleams into that slot will be doing a lot of damage. But the Glamora is pretty heavily threatened by Ivy Cudgel as well. So a lot of kind of rock, paper, scissors threats going back and forth here.
Yeah, really is going to determine on how these Pokemon have been trained. But actually, Colin is opting to just go for the Follow Me to protect the Fluttermane. Chupa protecting his own Ogerpon with that protect, eats a Moonblast for free from the spiky shield, and a huge Sludge Bomb from Glamora, boosted by the Power Herb Meteor Beam, picks up a one-hit KO. And this is what makes this new Meteor Beam Glamora so scary.
That's a rough turn for Colin there, but I think a really big play from Chepa. I think if the Ivy Cudgel comes out, it probably just straight up one-hit KOs this Glamora, which would be really rough for Chepa. But I think knowing that the Ogre Pond on his side has Follow Me, it's unlikely that Colin locks straight into that Ivy Cudgel because it could just easily be redirected and get not a whole lot done, which does kind of explain the option for the Follow Me Moonblast. You get a lot of damage off into Ogre Pond in that case, into a Chepa's Ogre Pond rather, with your Moonblast, and you set it up for a KO with your Chen Pao, which also frees up some space for Fluttermane. But instead, Chepa just takes a KO on Ogre Pond for nothing in return. Colin has yet to do any damage two turns into this game and is already down a full Pokemon.
Yeah, the only thing that has happened was a Meteor Beam into Protect, which still gave Chepa a special attack boost. All Terastalizations are still available, which is extremely powerful for this Teal Mask Ogre Pond specifically. But Colin playing a little bit scared here. The Chen Pao protects. Ogre Pond takes a Moonblast and fires back an Ivy Cudgel itself into Fluttermane. Ooh. Picks up another one-hit KO.
That is so big. This Fluttermane is now gone, which means that Colin's Booster Energy Fluttermane, one of the big sources of special type damage from this team, is now just gone. And again, no KOs taken for Chepa. He still has his original two Pokemon on the field and has finally taken at least one attack with that Moonblast, but it does stick around. Would be able to redirect something like an Ice Spinner from the Chen Pao on Colin's side, protect this Glamora for another turn, and possibly set it up for another big Sludge Bomb here. The Chen Pao's Focus Sash still intact, luckily, but the Ogre Pond and the Glamora still threatening it pretty heavily. The Superpower, obviously a big damage threat to Chen Pao. I kind of doubt we get to see the Ogre Pond attack one more time unless it's a Follow Me. But even if you do Follow Me, for example, you can redirect the Chen Pao's attack. Raging Bolt shouldn't be able to KO the Glamora in one hit, and it's probably slower than Glamora as well. So we should be seeing at least one more big attack from Glamora going forward.
All right, well, this Raging Bolt on the field would really threaten the Dondozo in the back, like you mentioned. Unaware, making those Draco Meteors extremely potent, but ooh, Chen Pao's actually going for an attack into the Glamora. The Sucker Punch hits into Glamora, deals good damage there. Of course, the Toxic Debris on the field doesn't matter anymore because all Pokemon are off. Ooh, double target into Glamora, double Sucker Punch, double Thunderclap. That Glamora is off the field. Managed to do some good work, but taking a lot of damage in return as Ogre Pond will fire off an Ivy Cudgel into Chen Pao. Not quite enough to knock it to its Focus Sash, but a good amount of damage, enough to pick up a KO, whatever hits it next, most likely.
This now becomes a little bit interesting because you see that Dondozo, Tatsugiri are the final two Pokemon Colin has at his, or Chepa has at his disposal. And we talked a little bit about how Raging Bolt's actually pretty strong into that combination. If the Dondozo comes out here, you have to worry about those Life Orbs, Thunderclaps, and Thunderbolts.
Yeah.
Terastalization's still an option for both trainers. I wouldn't be too surprised to see Colin invest it into that Raging Bolt, turn it into a Grass type, which would allow it to resist the Wave Crash and Earthquake and become neutral to that order up. Along the same lines, I wouldn't be surprised to see that Dondozo terastalize into a Grass type, especially if Chepa has a way to get rid of this Chen Pao, which threatens it with an Ice Spinner. But it's going to be interesting to see how this plays out, because now that the Raging Bolt has the option to go for these really strong attacks, the Ogre Pond can Follow Me one more time, which would effectively redirect Thunderclap if that's what the Raging Bolt goes for. But a risky play there with a double priority attack with the Sucker Punch, Thunderclap. Coming in handy as Glamora now is knocked out, losing that plus one special attack threat.
Yeah, and this is the combo that really threatens this Dondozo team. The electric type damage from the Raging Bolt and the ice type damage from the Chen Pao covering for a Terastalization. Colin will opt to go for the Terra Grass on the Raging Bolt, trying to remove all weaknesses to and resist basically everything except for Order Up from that Dondozo. That's a Spiky Shield from the Ogre Pond and a Protect from the Chen Pao and a Protect from the Dondozo this turn. So only the Raging Bolt will get to attack, fires off a Draco Meteor, trying to deal as much damage as possible into that Dondozo.
I think that's smart. If you're Chepa there, you get to see whether or not Colin wants to immediately go for that Terastalization. The downside now is that the Ogre Pond has used its Protect, so if you want to be attacking with it on this turn, you will have to worry about taking either a Sucker Punch or an Icicle Crash. But at the same time, At the same time, you can just swap in the Tetsugiri there, protect that slot from any kind of damage, boost up your Dondozo, and start trying to get some damage going. A plus two speed Dondozo should still be outsped by the Chen Pao and Colin's side. And you do, again, still have to worry about the super effective electric type damage coming through. But I think Colin smartly opting for the Draco Meteor on that last turn means that regardless of whether or not the Dondozo goes for Terra, you don't have to worry about the typing kind of whiffing the electric type damage.
Absolutely. You just don't want to miss out on any damage against these Dondozo turns after Tatsugiri has activated the commander ability, popped inside the catfish, and has started directing. Dondozo now at its full power. Ooh, no terrestrialization at all. The Thunderclap actually only doing less than half to the Dondozo, while Qian Pao's Ice Spinner will connect and take some Rocky Helmet damage. No damage from to the Dondozo that time around. Rocky Helmet damage onto the Qian Pao, but more importantly, this Earthquake will finally pick up the KO on Qian Pao. And now it is just Raging Bolt against the Dondozo, which has the Tatsugiri still to come and the Ogre Pond in the back. And that looks like Chupa may have just found a way to break through Colin.
Yeah, now it's looking rough for this Raging Bolt again. Even if you are able to knock out Dondozo with something like a Draco Meteor on this turn, you still have to worry about both the Ogre Pond and the Tetsugiri that Chupa has left. Again, once the Dondozo gets knocked out, Tetsugiri hops back out and is able to attack for itself. And we know it has access to both Draco Meteor and Dragon Pulse, which should be pretty consistent damage. And a Life Orb, boosted Thunderclap, probably not enough to KO it, especially if Chupa starts, or if Colin starts going for some Draco Meteors here.
Absolutely, and Chupa going for the
Up.
And just for good measure, the Draco Meteor misses onto Dondozo. And that's going to wrap things up here for Chupa in this game one. Figuring out a way, some great moves at the start to pick up that clean KO on both the Ogre Pond Wellspring Mask and the Fluttermane back to back in big plays from Chupa to get that early advantage that could start chipping down the Qian Pao. You saw the pin that Colin wanted to get to with Qian Pao and Raging Bolt against this Dondozo, but Chupa was just able to put Colin too far behind to really lock it in.
I really like the way that Chupa played this game. Getting that big KO onto the Ogre Pond on Colin's end very early on with that boosted Glamora was a huge piece of advantage for Chupa. I think when you're playing a team like Dondozo Tetsugiri, getting an advantage of Pokemon can be so beneficial because it starts to limit your options. It starts to limit your opponent's options into that Dondozo. I like the way Chupa played that, tried to create some space for the Dondozo later on in the game because once you know what your opponent has left, it becomes much easier to know how you should pilot that Dondozo Tetsugiri later on.
Absolutely, that's so key to Dondozo because as soon as the Dondozo and Tetsugiri are together on the field, you have limited a lot of your options. You can no longer switch out and you only have one Pokemon. So knowing all of the Pokemon that your opponent has brought allows you to make those choices like, do I need to terrestrialize this Pokemon yet? Is it safe for me to be a grass type Dondozo? Or am I really risking things by going for that too early? And being able to poke holes in Colin's team here, the Sludge Bomb picking up a one-hit KO, the Ivy Cudgel picking up a one-hit KO, both of those were huge knockouts that gave Chupa such an advantage going into this Dondozo endgame.
And they really did. I think especially Colin losing two Pokemon that soon before Chupa even lost one, it meant that once the Chen Pao Raging Bolt combo was on the field, even though that's kind of a strong combination into Dondozo in theory, there was just not enough left in the tank, especially when Chen Pao had to take an Ivy Cudgel and got into Earthquake range. It just became very difficult because once you get that one Earthquake off, it just becomes Raging Bolt against the world, and it's just not strong enough to take on those three Pokemon at once.
Absolutely, and the Dondozo proving itself here in Portland. It is January. It is the first regional of a new format. It is time for Dondozo to make it to the finals if Chupa can defeat Colin one more time. Colin, of course, though, still has plenty of options, has plenty of things at his disposal to bring Chupa to a game three. And you can see both these players really focusing in, locking in, trying to be ready for this.
It's cool too because Chupa has so many options with this team. We saw the Glamora and Ogre Pond lead in the first game, which is a big threat in and of itself, not even mentioning the Dondozo Tetsugiri that's in the back. But even if you focus solely on that Dondozo Tetsugiri, Chupa can also just bring out the Qian Pao Dragonite, and that's an entirely different beast that has a different list of things that counter it and perform well against it. So you have, it's very difficult to like select Pokemon against a team like this that can threaten you from a bunch of different directions.
Well, Colin is showing the Qian Pao early, going with the Qian Pao Fluttermane lead, And so is Chuppa. Chuppa is showing the Dondozo early, so leading the Dondozo with the Glamora alongside. I actually really like this lead from Chuppa because that Glamora with the Power Herb and the Meteor Beam can do big damage, but it's so sketchy to target the Glamora when Dondozo is already on the field.
That's the really hard part about playing against Dondozo. If it's on the field next to something that's not Tatsugiri, and Tatsugiri swaps in next to it, that slot just becomes untargetable. Mm-hmm. Well, not even untargetable. You can target it, but there's nothing there, so yeah, you just miss your attack. Yeah. Tatsugiri just avoids it because it's too busy piloting the Dondozo from within. So if you do try and go for like a nice spin or Shadow Ball into that slot for KO before it can get a big Meteor Beam off, and the Dondozo and the Tatsugiri combo happens, you're just kind of cooked. Mm-hmm. Like, it's really difficult to come back from that. So this is a tough spot to be in if you're Colin. And it's not like a double protect here really buys you a whole lot of time. It just kind of creates the same kind of 50-50 in the following turn. So even though that is what we see here, I guess trying to scout out a little bit, Chuppa not falling for it and leaving both Pokemon on the field.
Absolutely. And at least you don't have to take the Meteor Beam damage.
True.
You still get the special attack boost, but at least you're protected from the damage coming out from this Meteor Beam. But like you mentioned, you're now just at the same position here. That Glamora now has a special attack boost, and it can start firing off Sludge Bombs or go for Mortal Spins here just to try to spread poison on this team. And targeting it down feels really bad because Tatsugiri can always just come in and just mess up your entire game plan.
And the question also becomes, is Chuppa willing to switch out this plus one special attack Glamora to set up this Dondozo? Like, it becomes a much bigger target now that it has that special attack boost, but that you can just use that to kind of bait attacks into that slot, make them miss into the Tatsugiri that's no longer there, and just start firing off attacks with Dondozo. So it's got to be really careful if you're Colin, because I think at this point, if you start firing attacks into a missing Tatsugiri, it becomes a very big mountain to climb.
Mm-hmm. Well, these players are so close right now. Glamora does switch out. Chuppa was just going for the Meteor Beam damage, is not afraid to sacrifice that boost, and is going to bring the Tatsugiri on the field. Tatsugiri is now commanding the Dondozo as Chuppa begins to start spreading as much damage as possible with these commander boosts. At this point, with the Dondozo this early, you're just trying to get damage onto as many Pokemon on Colin's side as possible, but Colin does not fall for it. Sacred Sword connects with the Dondozo. Rocky Helmet will break the Focus Sash as Dondozo fires off the Wave Crash into Chien Pao. Critical hit knocks that Pokemon right out after the Rocky Helmet damage and takes the recoil itself. Now, this Fluttermane targeting down the Dondozo with a big Moonblast. Deals good damage, but crucially, this Dondozo was still faster than that Fluttermane.
Yeah, that's really important for both players. A lot of times, Fluttermane is still faster than a boosted Dondozo, especially because, you know, Dondozo naturally pretty slow, Fluttermane naturally pretty fast. But maybe giving away that Dondozo is trained to be a bit more speedy than normal, and Fluttermane and Chien Pao, importantly, targeting the Dondozo with both of their attacks. Colin reading through the Glamora bait and not falling for it. The Tatsugiri did not swiftly dodge any kind of attacks coming into that slot. And now Dondozo has been set up, but is in a pretty low health now. I think even a plus two Wave Crash should still be able to KO Fluttermane, though, so Colin has to be careful. And the Dragonite on his end, though it is holding the Choice Band, still has to worry about the plus two defense coming out from this Dondozo, so even a single Extreme Speed may not be able to KO.
Yeah, well, with the Terra Normal, Colin is trying to get as many multipliers as possible available to boost the damage of this Extreme Speed, but with Chien Pao off the field, this is full defense. Dondozo, Extreme Speed connects,
it picks up
the KO.
That's huge.
Dondozo is down, and Dondozo is down before the Fluttermane can move, exposing Tatsugiri to a Moonblast or a Dazzling Gleam.
Oh, this is such a good turn for Colin. Two huge KOs there. The Dondozo goes down to that Terra Normal Choice Band Extreme Speed. Just enough damage to knock it out and make that Tatsugiri vulnerable to a huge Moonblast. That's just the break that Colin needed. Now Chuppa is down to his final two Pokemon. It will be Chien Pao and the Glamora, but importantly, Glamora no longer has access to the Power Herb. You have to take two turns if you want to use that Meteor Beam, boost your special attack, so now you have to rely on Sludge Bomb for single target damage.
This Glamora, though, does match up pretty well into the Fluttermane and the Dragonite that is locked into Extreme Speed. You're not worrying too much about those Moonblasts or Dazzling Gleams. You're not worrying too much about those Extreme Speeds, although, of course, it does all add up.
Right. It's tough too, because I think the Chan Pao and Chupa Zen is the ghost type Terra. Mm-hmm. So if you do opt for that ghost type Terastalization, that makes the Dragonite not able to damage anymore. Luckily for Colin though, he does still have one Pokemon remaining. So if Chupa does go for that Terra Ghost, and the Dragonite and Fluttermane both survive this turn, you have the option to swap it out, reset your choice band, and decide to lock into something else. Terra Ghost is the play for Chupa now. The Chan Pao will not be able to be damaged by Extreme Speed anymore.
Yeah, Chan Pao is now immune to Extreme Speed. Fluttermane is protecting itself from all damage this turn. Dragonite also firing off Extreme Speed.
Right target, too.
Hits Glamora. That's so much damage on Glamora. That's a two-hit KO on Glamora. Drops the Toxic Debris, but still, being a two-hit KO is huge if Chupa can't get this Pokemon off the field right now, and he cannot. Ice Spinner into the Fluttermane. Fluttermane protected that turn. Glamora Sludge Bomb will connect, but not enough damage on the Dragonite.
That is a two-hit KO and a resisted Glamora. That's such a big turn for Colin, because now the Fluttermane, given that it's slower than Dondozo, it's probably safe to assume it's been trained to survive at least one Ice Spinner from this Chan Pao, will be able to break the Focus Sash with either Shadow Ball, Moonblast, Dazzling Gleam, take your pick. But Colin, Chupa rather, has no way to KO this Dragonite before it gets one more Extreme Speed off. So unless Glamora gets a couple spiky shields, it should be able to be knocked out by a Dragonite while the Chan Pao basically has to focus down this Fluttermane.
Well, Glamora's trying to get those spiky shields in, get that damage off onto the Dragonite. Spiking Shield does connect with the Extreme Speed, so taking a little bit of chip from that attack. Here comes the Ice Spinner, targeting down the Fluttermane. That's big damage, but Fluttermane,
wow.
Who needs a Focus Sash? My Booster Energy does that.
That's crazy. That is so low HP coming out from that Fluttermane. Colin also very shocked. I think maybe he was thinking that would do maybe a little bit less, maybe even KO, hard to tell. But Fluttermane hanging on just barely, firing off a Dazzling Gleam, which is enough to take the Chan Pao, break that Focus Sash. I like the Dazzling Gleam there too, because it makes sure that the Glamora, maybe it barely survives another Extreme Speed due to some damage rolls, but should get finished off. And you don't really need the full damage from Shadow Ball there, because again, it is holding a Focus Sash, that Chan Pao is. So now that that's broken, Glamora will need a double Protect, double Spiky Shield rather, to not get knocked out, most likely by another Extreme Speed from this Dragonite. And Colin still has a fourth Pokemon left as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, there is the Protect coming out from Fluttermane, trying to protect itself from any damage from the Chan Pao. No double Spiky Shield coming out from Glamora, which means this Extreme Speed will connect. It looked like it could possibly be a roll, but no, that's a two-hit KO into Glamora. Glamora goes down, and it is just this Chan Pao on the field against the Fluttermane and the Dragonite, and a fourth Pokemon in the back for Colin. And there's the Sucker Punch absolutely whipping into nothing. No shot there for this Chan Pao. Of course, the Dragonite is still locked into Extreme Speed, so it cannot touch the Chan Pao right now. And Chan Pao can damage the Fluttermane. And really, it's just a question of what this fourth Pokemon is. Is this Dragonite able to get back in before the Raging Bolt? That'll do it if it can survive Thunderclap and or an attack from this Fluttermane. Should be able to wrap this up for Colin.
Yeah, it looks like this should be pretty well sealed. Colin will be able to bring the Dragonite back in. And actually, I don't know, there's maybe a way that Chupa still wins this, because Dragonite comes in and it will get poisoned by the Toxic Spikes.
True.
If Chan Pao's able to get one or two Protects off, the Dragonite probably gets knocked out by, I think two turns. I think it's got to, I want to say it has one turn. Oh, it has way more turns
than
that.
It's got time.
I don't know why I thought it was lower than that. Okay, this is fine. I think Chupa needs like three or four Protects in order to win this, so the odds of that happening are quite low. But if there's a world where Chupa's able to stall out this Dragonite and make sure it gets knocked out by the poison, then you can try and win some like Sucker Punch, Thunderclap, Mind Games if you're this Chan Pao and get yourself a win. But unfortunately for Chupa, it looks like it's going to be much more difficult than that, because again, this Chan Pao does not have enough left in the tank to survive an attack from either of these Pokemon.
Absolutely. So just gonna, you know, Chupa is of course going to probably still play out this potential win condition, but will be very unlikely. And moving into a potential game three here, looks like that Dragonite has at least three more turns left in it. So that's a lot of protects, as Chupa probably gonna spend this time to think about what to do in a game three.
Yeah, Chupa going for it, does not get it, unfortunately. There is no need for Colin to panic as the double protect fails. Thunderbolt able to KO this Chan Pao and send us into a third game here in top four. Colin's tournament hopes still alive after what was a really rough game one. Chubba took some very early KOs, but Colin actually doing that in this second game, crucially, not attacking the plus one in special attack Lamora that switched out to Tetsugiri and getting some huge damage off into that Dondozo right away.
Yeah, Chubba really trying his hardest to bait Colin into targeting down that Glamora while switching in the Tatsugiri, but Colin absolutely not falling for it. That is a really important turn, because any additional turn that Dondozo has to fire off Earthquakes or Wave Crashes into the Pokemon that Colin brought would have been the difference there in the end. But because Colin correctly identified which Pokemon was going to stay in, which was going to switch out, that Dondozo was able to get a knockout on the Chien Pao, but it took so much damage in return, wasn't able to soften up the rest of Colin's team. And this extreme speed picking off the Dondozo was huge to expose Tatsugiri, which means that the entire combination was done and dusted.
You also have to wonder if Chubba knew that his boosted Dondozo would outspeed Colin's Fluttermane.
Mm-hmm.
If that's the case, maybe you target that with the Wave Crash instead. You know that the Chien Pao is going to break its Focus Sash on the Rocky Helmet, and so it will be vulnerable to another Wave Crash later on. And Fluttermane was the biggest damage dealer into that Dondozo, the Booster Energy Moonblast doing about, you know, half the Dondozo's HP, which allowed the Dragonite to come in and finish it with that crucial extreme speed.
Absolutely, and then this Dragonite just went off the two-hit KO onto Glamora with the extreme speed, made sure that Chubba did not have any real options there, and of course, Fluttermane surviving at one hit point, maybe two, at the maximum there, and able to continue threatening this Chien Pao, really putting Colin in the driver's seat and forcing this game three.
I'm so excited to see how these players mix it up. I really think that Chubba had a great game plan there. The immediate Glamora threat, which Colin really didn't respect in the first game, maybe trying to catch Colin, like overcorrecting for it and targeting it early and trying to swap it out to bait, you know, missing those attacks into the Tatsugiri. But Colin reading through that very well. I really like the Fluttermane Chien Pao because it threatens a lot of damage into really anything you can see on Chubba's team.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a whole lot that really wants to be facing down that booster energy Fluttermane. But I do think crucially, knowing that boosted Dondozo outspeeds Fluttermane is going to be big for Chubba.
Yeah, really important speed interaction.
Of course, yeah, because a plus two Wave Crash should pretty easily KO the Fluttermane, I would think.
Yeah, especially after that Ice Spinner almost picked up the KO on Fluttermane alone.
Yeah.
Like, that Wave Crash is so dangerous for any of the Pokemon on Colin's side to just be tanking, unless you're called Raging Bolt or Wellspring or Rabon.
Yeah. I don't know, it's going to be cool. The Raging Bolt, we saw it at the very end of that second game. I do still think it's a pretty big player for Colin here.
Absolutely.
I wasn't surprised to bring it, but we just didn't get to see it, you know, really be a big threat in that game just because it came in when the game was essentially already won.
Absolutely. Well, here are double Chien Pao's out on the field. Colin and Chubba both opting to bring that Pokemon, while Colin is also bringing Fluttermane to match off against Chuppa's Glamora. So again, the Glamora being led all three games for Chubba, potentially threatening that big Meteor Beam plus the special attack boost. But this time with the Chien Pao. So Glamora has seen three different partners this entire game.
Yeah.
First the Ogre Pond, then the Dondozo, and now the Chien Pao.
I like the Chien Pao mix up again. It threatens the Fluttermane more directly with the big Ice Spinner. We saw it almost KO in that first game, and we'll see what happens this game. Ice Spinner from Colin's own Chien Pao going to break that Focus Ashes. Chien Pao from Chubba goes into Fluttermane and is able to KO this time.
Oh, that was a roll. One hit KO this time around on the Fluttermane. Chubba not going for a Meteor Beam, instead just firing off a Sludge Bomb, breaking Colin's Chien Pao's Focus Sash, and saving the Power Herb if it needs to fire off one of those big Meteor Beams into a neutral target, like, say, this Raging Bolt.
That's a really rough break for Colin. You have to imagine if the Fluttermane survives there. It goes for a Dazzling Gleam, which would have KO'd Chien Pao and gotten some decent chip damage on Glamora, and more importantly, stuck around to threaten more damage on the coming turns, unless the Sludge Bomb also went into that slot. But if that's the case, then Chien Pao would still have its Focus Sash intact, and now you're still in a much better position than you were, now down three Pokemon to four, instead of possibly taking that early Pokemon lead. So I think maybe Colin's shock at the Ice Spinner survival in the second game, unfortunately flipping the other way this time as Fluttermane does not get a chance to attack at all.
Ooh, but Chien Pao hangs on against the Sucker Punch coming out from Chuppa's Chien Pao. A Thunderclap from the Raging Bolt will deal a lot of damage to the Glamora, but another Ice Spinner coming out onto the Glamora picks up that KO for Colin. So Chubba just barely missing out on the KO for Sucker Punch onto the opposing Chien Pao, and instead sacrifices the Glamora.
And you're at least evening the score, right? It's now 3-3. Unfortunately for Colin, you kind of need an advantage if you're playing up against Dondozo. Being even in Pokemon count is a really rough position to be in, especially now we're in that same position where Dondozo is on the field next to something that is not Tetsugiri, with Tetsugiri in the back. So you really have to worry about targeting that slot, because if you do and the Tetsugiri comes in, you're just losing possible damage in that turn. Raging Bolt in an okay position. Like, it is still weak to Earthquake, but Terrastalization is still an option. If it does turn into that grass type, it'll be resistant to both Wave Crash and Earthquake, and then become neutral to that order up. So kind of a triple win in terms of defense, unless you're facing down this Chan Pao, which is still relatively healthy.
Well, it looks like, you know, another Sucker Punch will be able to pick up the KO on to Colin's Chan Pao, which instead goes for a Protect in the face of Chuppa, also protecting Chan Pao, also protecting the Dondozo here. So all of Chuppa's Pokemon are in the Raging Bolt. So actually, Dondozo does not get to protect this turn because all Pokemon have tried to protect, so Dondozo's Protect fails.
It's a really precarious situation. You have to understand why these players are going for these Protects, especially for Colin. You really need to be careful about when this Tetsugiri comes in. Mm-hmm. So if we're able to protect on that turn, that means that Dondozo is now locked in the field with nothing next to it, so you're going to be solely targeting that slot. Chuppa, I think, correctly seeing through that, opts instead to go for the Protect himself, not give Colin any information that could make his next couple turns easier, because now Colin still has to worry about the possibility of a Tetsugiri swap or the possibility of a Chan Pao going on the offense. Like, Sacred Sword or Ice Spinner would both be huge damage into either of these two Pokemon in Colin's end.
Well, Dondozo is actually going to switch out this time for Tatsugiri. Normally, you don't see the Dondozo switch out for Tatsugiri. You see Tatsugiri switch out next to the Dondozo, but here is the option that Chuppa is going for, bringing the Choice Scarf Tatsugiri out on the field while Chan Pao is going to Terrastalize into the Ghost type here and prevent itself from taking a Sacred Sword or potentially some other damage coming out from Colin's Pokemon. But it will be matched by a Terrastalization of Colin's own. That is the Raging Bolt now becoming the Grass type Pokemon to dodge those Earthquakes.
No Earthquake damage coming out though, because Dondozo did swap out. We're gonna see how this plays out here. Opposing Chan Pao goes for Sacred Sword into Chuppa's. That's such a good play from Chuppa, because now Ice Spinner goes straight into that Grass-type Raging Bolt for the KO. Massive turn for Chuppa, because now no damage comes out from Colin's side. This Dondozo and Tatsugiri now perfectly set up for a win, because there is no more Raging Bolt threatening that super effective electric-type damage, threatening those massive Draco Meteors. And now the Ogre Pond on Colin's end is his final hope.
Incredible play there by Chuppa, becoming the Ghost Terra typing, dodging the Sacred Sword, getting the Tatsugiri out on the field for free, which is now Choice Scarfed and actually pretty threatening with the ability to lock into Draco Meteors if it wants to. Of course, it could also just bounce into the Dondozo by switching back out the Chan Pao and then saving that for later.
You do kind of lose a turn of momentum if you do opt to swap Dondozo into this Chan Pao, like I believe we saw Chuppa lock into. But at this point in the game, I think that's okay. Mm-hmm. You at least get a turn of poison damage on this Ogre Pond, which could come in handy. Again, a water grass type is going to be immune to the Wave Crash thanks to Water Absorb, and neutral to the Earthquake coming out from Dondozo. So you kind of have to order up that slot for damage. Not the strongest right off the bat, thanks to the lack of same type attack bonus. So you are just starting to chip, add up that poison chip. You're keeping your own Chan Pao safe for later on, which is great. I think at a certain point, a Sucker Punch is able to KO anything left, and that's kind of a great end game. But now Dondozo is on the field. You do still have to worry about those super effective Horn Leeches, but at the plus two defense, especially with the Rocky Helmet adding to that passive chip damage, it might be a little rough.
Yeah, you've got Horn Leeches coming out from the Ogre Pond. You maybe have Sacred Swords coming out from the Chan Pao, but Chan Pao is so low that the Rocky Helmet damage will be able to pick up that KO. So really, it is all about this Ogre Pond, which went for the Tatsugiri, which means that a wasted turn for Chuppa, not a wasted turn at all, protected Tatsugiri, and now has the full power Dondozo ready to bring Chuppa to another finals.
Yeah, it's really rough for this Chan Pao on Colin's end, because Rocky Helmet would KO it as soon as it makes contact with this Dondozo. The Ice Spitter and Sacred Sword both being contact moves. I'm not sure if Sucker Punch is, actually.
It should be.
I think it is. It probably is. But regardless, again, not much damage will come out anyway, because this Dondozo now is at plus two defense and is opting to protect itself. Just get some more poison chip damage going on this Ogre Pond and allow it to kind of set itself up for an endgame sweep here.
Yep, this is just what Dondozo and Glamora do. They stall out, they let the poison chip down. If you have a Pokemon that should otherwise match up well into Dondozo, you have to figure, does it match up well after 4 or 5 turns of poison tick damage? That's what this Ogerpon is going to be facing, as Chien-Pao can't attack the Dondozo without knocking itself out thanks to the Rocky Helmet. And that's a big order up. This Ogerpon is not long for this world. Good damage coming out from the Horn Leech will be able to recover some of that health back. It will then, of course, immediately lose it back to the Rocky Helmet and then the poison. And now this Dondozo has more buffs. One more order up, one more Earthquake, picks up both KOs, and that will move Chupa into the finals.
Horn Leech kind of delays the bleeding a little bit for Cullen, but unfortunately this Earthquake at +3 attack should be more than enough for a KO here. Going for one more Protect, just to make it even safer, get that one more round of poison damage onto Ogerpon, and at that point, any kind of damage into either slot will be more than enough. So Chupa, even though he dropped that second game after, you know, the Dondozo taking some early damage, says, I'm gonna run it back, I'm gonna make sure this Dondozo brings me into the finals of another January regional championships. We're gonna see this Dondozo-Tatsugiri combination order up a victory.
Yep, that is textbook Dondozo play coming out from Chupa.
Yeah.
Don't go for the Earthquake when you don't need to. You can always protect and add another tick of poison damage. And now, finally able to fire off this Earthquake, picks up the KO on the Ogerpon, and again, this Chien-Pao simply cannot do anything. There are no outs for Colin here. There isn't even timer as an out because Chupa has preserved his Pokemon so well, up 3-2 Pokemon, and that's before Ogerpon goes down. Chupa is going to be moving on to the finals today.
And you have to feel for Colin too. Colin absolutely had play in this third game. Mm-hmm. There are a couple turns that just did not go his way. The first being the Fluttermane getting knocked out by that Ice Spinner. The same attack it survived in game two, which was crucial. And of course, the Sacred Sword into the Terra Ghost Chien-Pao, I think kind of sealed the deal at that point. At that point, Colin had just lost way too many resources to keep up with that massive Dondozo that came in the following turn.